I go to you for what you give, not who you are. I wonder if you leave for me. God, just tell me what you need for me. Is the Holy Spirit still in me? God, I'm asking you for clarity. Even though you told me already. God told me I'm someone. Told me I'm someone. Told me I'm someone. Told me I'm, told me I'm. Told me I'm someone. Told me I'm someone. Know that I'm someone. No, I'm a child of God.
Straight to it.
It's whatever you say, yeah. I'm just thanking you for a new day.
covered us. I'm just glad you delivered us. In my past, it's no hindrance. Cause you're so powerful, you are. Powerful, you are.
Good morning. Welcome to chapel this morning. I got two announcements before we get started. First one is this. Right after chapel, we're having, Beth, could you go to that lunch church slide? Right after chapel, we're having Pete Christie's lunch church. Pete Christie is a local sportscaster with KCBD. And so right after chapel, if you'd like to go hear him speak, Coach Giacomazzi will give a devotional, and then Pete Christie will be speaking. It's upstairs in UC 211. You just go through the line and then just go right upstairs above the calf and to hear Pete Christie and Coach Giacomazzi. Okay, there'll be other people up there from the community, so you just grab your tray and go on up. All right, second announcement is this. Next week is National Collegiate Day of Prayer next Thursday. So we're going to have 72 hours of prayer. So it'll start on Tuesday at 8 o'clock, and it'll go till Thursday at 8 o'clock. And we're asking you to sign up for 30 minutes prayer times. You can sign up for an hour if you want to. Okay, so what you need to do is scan that QR code, and we're giving you first shot, all right? So if you want to pray at 8 o'clock or noon, you scan that QR code. You pick your times that you want to do it. You can pick multiple times. You can pick an hour if you want to. You have to pick two 30-minute blocks. You can pick Tuesday, Thursday, whatever. And Thursday night at 8 o'clock, we'll have a prayer and worship time in the SMAC. And so to conclude our 72 hours of prayer, we'll conclude that with the time of worship and prayer all together. All right, so you sign up for that, 72 hours. That's a lot of prayer going on. We're just going to pray for God to move on our campus and around the world. Other colleges, it's National Day of Prayer, so not just in America, but all over the world, people are praying for you guys as college students. Our campus has been adopted by several people, so several people are praying specifically for you, and especially on next Thursday. So join us as we pray. There'll be a prayer tent located in the marsh that you can go and pray at, or you can just pray in your dorm room or wherever, but there'll be a place that you can go and pray together with other students. All right? This morning I've asked Evan. Evan's going to come and lead us in our scripture and our prayer, so I'd ask you to stand as we read God's word together.
Hey, good morning, y'all. I know y'all have read the yellow one time and y'all have read the white, but this time we're all going to read it together. That sound all right? Yeah. All right, let's read. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. 2 Corinthians 4:7-10. Y'all pray with me. Father God, thank you for this wonderful day, Father. Thank you for your love, your grace, your mercy, and your peace, Father, that you've shown all of us, Father. Father, I come praying that you just be in this room with us, Father, and that you just give the worship team to just be here boldly and worship freely, Father. And let us in the crowd, Father, feed off of that and be able to worship you always, Father. I pray that you speak through Nicole, Father, as she brings the message, Father, that you have given her, Father. And I pray that you give every unbeliever and believer in here ears to hear, Father. Let us as believers continue to live like you live, Father. And for the unbelievers, Father, let the gospel be preached, Father, in the best way it can be preached, Father. You are awesome and you are holy, and we thank you for the cross, Father. We thank you for sending your son down and dying for our sins, Father. So with that, Father, let us worship you freely. Let us worship you in spirit and in truth and praise your holy name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's worship God, y'all.
Then he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Beggars, and now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. 'Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this. Won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Whoa, whoa. Shout out your praise.
you gotta praise in the prison. Cry out to heaven, shout till the doors swing wide. Sometimes you gotta stand on your shackles, brave in the battle, worship with your hands held high. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all of the praise. Give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Of all of the praise. Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why. I'll praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath. I'll praise you anywhere. Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, reasons why. I'll praise you anywhere. Every promise, goodness, every step, each and every breath. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy, yes, he is worthy of all of the praise. Give him praise, give him praise
For today and just this opportunity we have to worship you and to just learn more about you, God. I pray that you would just speak to us and speak through Nicole and give her the words to say, God. And I just pray that we would be a light shining for you throughout the rest of this day and this week and this semester, God. I just pray that you would continue to guide us to live like you would have us live and just to be your blessing and your presence on earth. It's in your name we pray.
You were born into a world of broken dreams, of resentment and disillusionment birthed out of longings left unfulfilled. There seems to be no end to this relentless cycle of chasing the wind, only to have it leave you empty, hungry, yearning for more. The silence of insignificance screams at you, keeping you awake at night while you desperately search for a purpose to direct your passion. The longing unfulfilled tears at the core of your being until you succumb to the apathy that pervades this generation. But you were made for more. More than the disappointment of failed relationships. More than the fear that you'll never measure up. God is calling you, reminding you that what He's done before, He will do again. He chooses ordinary people for extraordinary miracles. He is able to do exceedingly, abundantly more than you can imagine, more than you can ask, more than you can dream. And He's asking, will you come with me? You were born to lead. You were created to live deeply, audaciously, fiercely connected to community and rooted in Jesus. So when the temptation to hit autopilot returns, stand up, shake off the apathy, and remember, you are made for more.
Oh man, hello everybody. Everyone say hi, Nicole.
Hi, Nicole.
Okay, that was a little bit better. Mediocre at best, but I'm here for it. Guys, I am incredibly grateful. Do y'all hear that? Can we work through it? Do I need to move? Ah. Hey, thanks, Matt. Y'all are the best. All right. Guys, I am incredibly grateful to have this opportunity to chat with you guys. These are moments that I do not take lightly. The fact that I get to come up here and I get to share about the Lord, share about what He's done in my life, and share about the hope that we have in Him is something that will always and forever hold a very great weight in my heart. Especially standing here being a woman, right? Like, that's a huge deal. And so I am just incredibly grateful that you are here and you are willing just to give me your time, give me your attention, and let me point you to some truths for just a little bit. So, are y'all ready for that?
Yeah.
All right. Just go with it. All right. It'll be fine. We'll have fun. It'll be okay. All right. So whenever we started, Donnie asked me to speak. Obviously, we've been going over the fruits of the Spirit. And he said, here are some options that you can do. And I said, oh, my goodness. You know, I would love to go up there and talk about love. Like, the fruit of the Spirit that is love, that would be awesome. All right, that's great. I could point you to Jesus. Not a big deal. And he looked at me and said, Nicole, that is not available. And I said, awesome. And Kyra last week did a great job talking about love and how God is love for us. And so then I started thinking, and I was like, he's like, self-control is open. I'm like, I am not the girl for that. That is not going to be happening today. And then he brought up the subject of joy. And I'm like, joy, that's cool. All right, I can do that. So I said, yes. And then immediately hung up the phone. So I lied earlier. He did not look me in the eyes. He proverbially did. But I hung up the phone and I started to panic. Because joy, though I do often try to show joy in my life and to engage with people in a way that is a joyful way, but there are often times in my life whenever that is very, very hard in a private setting. Many people don't know is that I have struggled with depression for quite a while. And there are times that it is difficult for me to even get off my couch, let alone do the things that I know that the Lord has called me to do, right? And so whenever we think about joy, sometimes that can be kind of a hard discussion, right? And I think many of us can relate to that, right? That sometimes whenever we think about joy, usually we think about these mentalities like, pull yourselves up by your bootstraps, or we think about mentalities like, turn that frown upside down, fake it till you make it, everything's gonna be fine. I am a strong, independent woman, I got this, right? We think about those mentalities because that's what we're told day in and day out. All right, you've also heard this idea that whenever we think about joy, that joy is a choice. All right, happiness is a fleeting moment, but joy is a choice. But today, what I want us to do is I want us to get just a little bit deeper than that. Today, you might hear something you never heard, or it might be a really sweet, subtle reminder from the Spirit. Whatever it is, I just ask that you come to the table ready for the Lord to speak to your soul. All right? And I want to say this disclaimer. Whenever we talk about the joy of the Spirit, know that all things come in seasons. And you know that there are times that the Lord truly does use godly sorrow. Okay? And so now that we have that, can we all be on the same page? And we are going to talk about joy of the soul today. Joy of the soul. And so if you would, please, with me, for my own good, we are going to stop and we are going to pray, but we're going to do this in a very specific way. I'm going to facilitate some guided prayer. So what I want you to do is you're going to bow your heads, you're going to close your eyes. This is what I tell my youth group, shut your mouths. And I'm going to give you something to pray about. And I want you to take a moment and I want you to do that. Now, some of you are like, man, Nicole, I have never prayed. That seems ridiculous and dumb. I get it, all right? Basically, whenever we think about prayer in this context, you're just talking to God in your head and you're pretending like he's in the same room as you. Okay? That's all I want you to do. All right? And if you still are not at the point where you're like, man, I don't even know if God exists, try it. Try it. All right? Can we all do this? Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Bow your heads, close your eyes, shut your mouths. Let's do this. All right, I want you to take a moment. Hey, there are no exceptions. Bow your heads, close your eyes, shut your mouths. All right, I want you to take a moment, and I want you to thank God for something. Maybe it's the fact that you got out of bed today. Maybe it's your friends and your family. I want you to take a moment and just praise him and tell him why you are thankful for those things in your life. Okay, now I want you to take a moment and I want you to talk to him
if there is anything that might be coming in between you and what God has for you today, I want you to tell him about it. Maybe it's an argument with a friend. Maybe it's a test that you have immediately after this. Maybe it's the fact that you have practice and you need to go and eat. Or maybe it's the fact that you have sin that has boggled your brain. I want you to take a moment and just tell him. And ask God to meet you here. Now I want you to pray that your heart and your mind can be open to him. And while you're at it, pray for the people sitting next to you. Ask that God cares for them. Ask that God speaks to them. And lastly, I ask that you pray for me selfishly. Ask that the Lord speak through me and that I can say only what he wants me to say. And I can do that boldly and confidently. Father God, we come into this place knowing that you are a God that is present. That you are not a God that creates and walks away, but you are a God that every single day engages with your people. That, Father, through your Spirit, we have complete access to you. And that, Father, you do not leave us. And so, God, I just pray that as we move forward in trepidation, that as we take this journey together, Father, I just ask that you work here. And that what is said, what is done, what is seen is not done for anyone's glory except for yours. Father, I pray that this can be a worthy act of worship. Dedicated to you. And so, Father, we give you this time. We pray this in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. All right. So, again, we've been speaking about the Spirit, the fruits of the Spirit, okay? And so, group participation, this is fun. All right. What are some of the fruits that we have already discussed? And plot twist, it is not like watermelon and apples and oranges. Super cute. What are some of the fruits that we've already discussed? Love. I gave you that one. That was cheating. Thank you, front row here. What about over here? What's another fruit do you remember? Goodness. I really enjoyed that. Did y'all see that slideshow? That was pretty sick. All right. We talked about goodness. We talked about the goodness of the Lord. All right. Talking about how he has been good for history and he is good again and is good for us. All right. What else? Faith. Faithfulness? Did we talk about faithfulness? I don't know. However, I do know because I cheated before this. And one that I was not here for was peace. All right? Do y'all remember that? Thank you. I love that. All right. So already we've started this precedence of what the fruit of the Spirit are. All right. And so it is my job to take that and to carry that on. And so one of the most important things whenever we think about the fruits of the Spirit, we've already learned this, is what? Let me tell you, because I forget, there's a lot of you. This is not an intimate class setting. All right, whenever we think about the fruit of the Spirit, the most important part is that it is of the Spirit. That whenever we try to bear fruit just on our own accord, just because for kicks and giggles, because we feel like it, that doesn't always work, right? But literally, fruits of the Spirit are fruits of the Spirit of the living God active and breathing inside of us. Active and breathing inside of us. So it is imperative that whenever we approach the subject of joy, that we remember that a joy of the soul is not something that we will and that we urge ourselves to have, but it is something that the Lord gives us opportunity for. And it's something that the Spirit implants in our soul, all right? We have to remember that the Spirit of God is at work and that this kind of joy comes from Him and only Him. And so whenever we think about living a life that resembles Christ, that bears fruit, that can be shared with those around us, this type of thing, whenever we think about bearing fruit, people, does this happen overnight? Okay, I want you to close your eyes and I want you to think about a Christian. I want you to think about one in particular. Don't say any names because that would be silly, all right? And I want you to think about that person. You got that person visualizing in their head. Think about their name. It might be yourself. I don't know. All right, open your eyes. Look at me. Whenever you think about that person, is that person perfect? Has that person messed up? Thank God that we are covered by the blood of a perfect God. Thank God that whenever God looks at us, He does not see our imperfections, but He sees His Son inside of us whenever we accept Him into our lives. Thank God. But as Christians, man, resembling the Spirit can be tough. All right, I remember distinctly growing up. I grew up in Amarillo, not far from here, you know that. But I went to a teeny tiny school called Claude. Does anyone know where Claude is? All right, I'm here for that. All right, so Claude. I loved Claude. It was great for the most part, as most schools are. And one of my very best friends, her family, they were ranchers. So that's important. You need to know, small town, ranching community, all of that. And I remember talking to her dad named Joe. That's fun. His name's Joe. I remember talking to Joe about his moment or about the whenever he started following the Lord. And he said, I remember distinctly what it was like that moment whenever I gave my life over to Christ. And it's funny because he said two things happen. He said, one, obviously, he came into my life, all right, and I was made new. He said, secondly, I used to love dipping. That was my favorite thing in the world, you know, dipping. He's like, that was my favorite thing in the world. And in that moment, the Lord took it from me. He said, I did not have the urge to do that anymore. I'm like, oh, awesome, pretty cool. And he said, now drinking and partying, on the other hand, that was a different story. Right? I believe that there are moments that the Lord says, hey, I'm going to meet you in this. All right, we're going to get this. And it's like the snap. And whenever we follow Christ, there are things that change. But then there are many things in our lives. There are many things in our lives that whenever it comes to following Christ, it takes time. That's it. It takes time and it takes looking to the Spirit to begin refining us. We call this process sanctification, which is just a really pricey word for time and process. And this idea of sanctification happens your entire life, right? Christians will always need to grow. All right, so if you're a Christian in the room and you're like, nah, I got all of this, I am checked, you're wrong. You're wrong. But Christians, it is a part of our being that whenever we walk with the Spirit, the Lord takes that and He makes us more and more like Him. So that whenever we grow in the Spirit, we're able to bear these fruits and we're able to share them with people. And we're able to point them not to ourselves because we're super cool, but we're able to point them to the one who really actually matters. Really actually matters, okay? So whenever you think about joy, I want you to think about that, all right? Because many of you might be naturally happy or joyful, I don't know. But for many of us, joy, the joy of the soul, it takes time, all right? And as you're hearing all these lessons, I want you to have grace with yourself. Have grace with yourself, but proceed, all right? So more often than not, whenever we think about the Spirit and we think about growing in His likeness and developing those fruits, all right? More often than not, the Spirit teaches us those by putting us in environments in which these fruits can be cultivated. All right, let me say that again. More times than not, whenever the Lord is trying to teach us something, He is putting us in an environment for us to practice and for that fruit to be cultivated, to be watered, to be grown. Okay? And so God more often gives us environments in which gifts can be cultivated. I had to read it so I know where I'm at, you know? All right, so for instance, let's talk about this. For instance, examples, we love those. Peace is often sown, planted in our lives, and grown, developed in our lives through seasons of uncertainty, right? Peace, you're feeling nervous, you're feeling anxious, you don't know what's going on. Oftentimes, we learn what peace is. We get to experience the peace of the Spirit, sometimes at its heaviest and its most, whenever we are uncertain and we are concerned, okay? The second, patience. This one's easy. Patience is oftentimes developed and sown in an environment of waiting. Right? It doesn't help us if you're patient for something that's instant gratification, right? But patience, more often than not, is sown whenever you have to wait for it. All right, kindness. Many times, you learn to be kind during seasons of hurt. Someone has hurt you. You have seen someone else hurt somebody else, and you say, I'm not going to be a part of that. I'm going to be kind. Y'all tracking with me? Say yes, Nicole. I can't see your faces, so I'm struggle bussing. All right, and the last one, faithfulness. This is kind of crazy because we hear that this is super, super bad all of the time. But so many times, the environment that cultivates faithfulness is doubt. Sometimes whenever we look to the Lord in seasons of doubt, that is whenever we learn what true faithfulness is, okay? And so we're just going to pause for a second. All right, and with the people sitting next to you, there are no exemptions to this. I want you to think about, what is the environment in which joy is cultivated? What is the environment in which joy is cultivated? You're going to think about that. You're going to talk about it. You're going to have 20 seconds. Go. I don't hear voices. Go. Thank you. You have about 10 seconds, so if you haven't said anything, open your mouths now. Also, now is not the time to talk about your lunch plans. All right, perfect. All right, yell it out real fast. What? One word, that's all you get. You're not preaching. I am today. So whenever we think about the environment that cultivates joy, what does that environment look like? Valley, music. Oh, fun. Music, a valley. What else? Sorrow. What else? Huh? Quiet. I know y'all are saying stuff in the back, and I'm so sorry. Baseball. I love that. No, that's awesome. God, Chick-fil-A. All right, it's getting weird. All right, everybody, shut your mouths. All right, so whenever we think about joy, all right, many of you said some really great things. Some of you said some okay things. I'm going to give you that. All right, but whenever we think about joy, Scripture more often points us to sorrow. That suffering, valleys, are the environment that cultivate joy. Right? So one of you said baseball over here, right? If you just went out and you won every single game and it came super naturally to you all the time, like, yeah, that would be sick. That would be awesome. But there is nothing like going out, losing, and then finally figuring it out as a team and then pulling it together and bringing it home, right? That feels good, right? That feels good. You look at that and you're like, man, there was something to that, okay? I know you're thinking, we'd just rather win. I get it. Just go with it, okay? But there is something about suffering that the Lord uses to cultivate joy. All right, I'm keeping track of time. All right, bear with me for a little bit. All right, so let me talk a little bit about my personal experience. And I don't have time to go into this full detail, but whenever I was in my mid-20s, I had a four-year relationship. People look at me and they're like, Nicole, why don't you ever date? I'm like, guys, it's hard. It's so hard. And it's because during those 4 years, like I thought that, like I said, this is it. I'm done searching, we're good, and this is gonna be the end all be all, right? And I was gonna get married, I could see my future, it's gonna be so cool, awesome, fine. All right, then obviously that did not happen, right? Just because of life, guys, because of life and weird circumstances, that did not happen. All right, and then in this moment, everything that I had kind of defined in my mind for what life would look like disappeared. All right, everything that I had made this person such a huge piece of my life and a huge piece of my well-being. All right, even to the point, like, I could barely afford to even, like, be in the home that I was in. We weren't living together, but he would help me because I couldn't afford it. Right, so even down to the nitty-gritty, like, I was totally reliant. And that whenever this relationship was taken away from me, man, it hurt more than anything in the world. All right, and you talk about suffering, like, yeah, breakups. Oh, that's tough, Nicole. We go through breakups all the time. One, I get it. But two, like, to me, like, that was pain. And that was suffering during that time. But the cool thing about that is that whenever I got into it, and we'll talk a little bit more about this later, but whenever I got into it, I realized that the entire time the Lord was taking care of me. And leading into that moment, the Lord was taking care of me. And so let's say this. James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4. Explain joy, the relationship between suffering and joy like this. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. Because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. And let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. All right, and so whenever we face trials, all right, and in James, you know, there was a lot to their trials, and sometimes our trials look a little bit different this day and age, but many times they look similar. But whenever we face trials, he's saying, consider it pure joy, not just a little bit of joy, but like whole joy whenever you face those trials. And I know many of you are looking at me and you're like, Nicole, that makes no sense. Why on earth would I consider suffering? Why on earth would I consider pain something to be joyful about? And it seems like a jump to get from point A to point B. But remember, who are we forgetting? The Holy Spirit, all right? And so oftentimes whenever we make that jump, many times, have you ever met anybody who's like, weirdly optimistic all of the time? You're like, I do not see that. Or you've met somebody who's super pessimistic and they're just angry about everything all of the time. Rough, right? Whenever we, in psychology, whenever we think about a healthy psyche, it's not the one who's overly optimistic. It's not the one who's pessimistic all of the time. But really, it's the one who's realistic. It's the one who can look at something, call a spade, and then assess how we need to go forward. All right, and so whenever we look at joy, we want to be realistic about it. Whenever we look at suffering, we want to be realistic about it. You cannot just snap your fingers and then all of a sudden, the death of somebody that you love becomes this most joyful thing. Sometimes things just hurt, right? Whenever you lose somebody you love, it hurts. And scripture is not saying, look at this, and then it'll be fine. Just change your mentality, right? It's not saying that. It's not saying that, but it's telling you to persevere. It's telling you that you do not stop, but you keep going, all right? And so there must be a bridge. There must be a bridge that gets us from suffering to joy. from suffering to joy. Because left in our own devices, suffering, we start spiraling. Something crazy happens, we have a bad day, and I don't know about you, but man, I just want to talk trash about it. I'm stressing about it. Life gets really, really rough, and you just start spiraling. And so there is something specific that the Spirit uses to direct us to joy. And the Holy Spirit provides that bridge by giving us hope. The Holy Spirit provides that bridge by giving us hope. The bridge that connects sorrow to joy is literally hope. Okay? So Paul describes it as this in Romans chapter 5, verses 3 through 5. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings. Oh, man. So he's talking about glorying in the Lord, but we also glory in his sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance. We know that perseverance produces character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. If you look at the bottom of this, because God loves us, because he sent his son, because he paid the debt that we no longer have to live in debt, that whenever we accept him, he gives us this gift of the Holy Spirit. And because we have the Spirit, we are gifted the promise of hope in our sufferings. All right, so whenever we are down, whenever we are at our lowest of lows, God says no. He says no, you do not stop. He says you persevere. And you do this by you look towards that end goal and you say, what is the hope? What is the hope? All right, you do not become joyful just by being like, everything is rainbows and butterflies. No. You become joyful by looking at the hope that the Lord has instilled in your life. All right, the hope of people who love you. The hope of the fact that you actually get to go to the university, go to school, whenever so many people in this world do not get education up to this point. You look at the hope that maybe, just maybe, there is purpose in your suffering. That maybe, just maybe, at the end of the day, the Lord is cultivating something. All right, so in my instance, remember, suffering, lost relationship, tough. But what I didn't realize is the stuff that was at play. But right before we had broken up, I got a second job working at a church that paid me more than my full-time job. That took care of me, that loved me, that gave me a home. And that gave me a place that I could just be and minister and not only pour into the youth, but that also cared about me. All right, and so during this really deep time of hurt, I was still being cared for. That wasn't there before. All right, second, gave me a new house. Pretty stinking cool. All of that. Third, gave me a raise. Pretty stinking cool. And then I started looking around, and there was this moment that I'm like, God, this was nothing like I planned. This was nothing like I planned. There's nothing like I planned. And then all of a sudden, I looked up and I said, my God, I love it. That I get to pour my life into people, and I get to pour my life into ministries, and I get to tell people how who Jesus is and the goodness that he is. And yes, I am suffering, but my God, I have never experienced joy like this in my entire life. That every single day I get to go and I get to be grateful for what I get to do. How neat is that? How neat is that? So when we see hope played out, we see it played out throughout all of Scripture. You think about Abraham. I'm sliding in a home. Bear with me, okay? But whenever we think of Scripture, hope has been played out throughout all of Scripture. We think about Abraham, the very father, right, of the Israelites, of our religion, all right? Was it easy for Abraham to have children? No! That's like a pillar. You got to know that, all right? So it was not easy. The Lord said, you will have children. No children. You will have children. No children. There is even a weird little covenant thing with some flaming pots. Super cool. And then he said, you will have children. It's going to be as numerous as the stars. And at this point, it's been decades. Decades. Abraham and his wife, Sarah, they're like, no kids. They tried different things. They tried to figure it out themselves. Time and time again, they did not have children. But the entire time, what did God promise them? Children. Children. Guys, sometimes it is so difficult for us to see the hope that's in our lives, but I promise you, it is there. I promise you, it is there. If not in the immediate moment, we always have the hope that is in Jesus Christ. But every single time, the Lord is going to give you hope. That even in the midst of your suffering, even in the midst of your chaos, you are not left alone. Abraham, he went through wars. He had falling out with his relatives, right? It was chaos for him. But eventually, Abraham has a son. He has Isaac. Isaac has Jacob. Jacob wrestled with the Lord. The Lord changed his name to Israel. Israel had 12 sons, thus creating the Israelites. Sometimes hope looks so different than what you think that it will. But I guarantee you, time and time again, it's there. Time and time again, the Lord is going to care. And he's going to come through for you. All that you need to do is see it and go towards it. See it and go towards it. All right? So a few challenges before we leave. First, one, sanctification is refinement, right? It is a beautiful, I'm just going to read this. It is a beautiful lifetime of continual work from the Spirit. And guys, maybe you feel like you're like, man, I'm pretty joyful. I got joy unlocked. We are good. There is nothing wrong. All right? Super cool, right? I love that for you. I don't know. Love it for you. But I'm going to encourage you. Look at the environment that you're in, and I want you to assess what fruit is the Lord trying to cultivate in my soul? If spiritual formation is a daily process, the Lord is working with you. He is working with you, or you are not an exception. What environment is the Lord using to cultivate his Spirit and his work in your life? All right. Second, I want you to think about. There are some of us in here and you're like, Nicole, that's great. I love that you love hope. And I love that you love joy, but I don't see it. I don't see it. And if you are that person in this room, I want to, please, all right, this matters, okay? So listen. If you are that person in this room, I want you to know that our God is the God that sees. And that even whenever you are in the depths of your despair, that when all you can see is pain and suffering and depression and there is no light, that our God joins you in that. That our God sees you in that. And he does not leave you. Okay, and so your job, you persevere and you look for that hope. Even if it is a glimmer, you look for it and you remember that you are not left in it. And then third, you cannot know joy in your suffering if you do not know hope. The ultimate hope, as we know, all right, we've heard this week after week after week after week, but the ultimate hope, and I mean this from the bottom of my soul, is only found in Jesus Christ. All right, you will continue to spin your wheels. You will continue to look in desperation, to wonder, and you will continue to do that if you do not slow down and say, God, I need you. God, I understand I cannot do this on my own. And Father, I need you to meet me here. And if you have questions about that, talk to me. talk to somebody, or pray. Go to the Lord and tell him just that, and he's going to meet you, okay? But you need to know that there are people here that want nothing more than to point you to hope, okay? Are y'all good with that? So three things. And I'm going to leave you with this very last verse coming out of Romans 15:3. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Spirit. Guys, thank you for your time. Thank you for your attention. Guys, please go and walk in joy. Look for hope. I'm giving them time to get to the doors. We love you. Goodbye. Thank you.
Electrifying, yeah. Only talk I do is edifying. They say preach, they say church when I'm testifying. Hear you running at the mouth, that's a lot of mileage. Grew up in the woods 30 miles from the nearest college. Saw a pair of rebel flags, I'm not being parabolic. Parent teacher conference, they weren't okay with my swag. Wore the Malcolm X t-shirt with the AK on the back. Yeah, Dilly, I don't need the fake to make a couple dollars. I get validation from the conversation with my father. I just float atop the wave like an otter. Write a verse in my garage and it get played in Jakarta. I was listening to Illmatic on vinyl and I thought, where did rhymes go? People want the vibes, but I gotta give them life though. Rappers don't revise, cut the fat like some lipo. Shout to Post Malone, kill the beat like a psycho. Indie tribe mitochondria, I'm in a cell. Intel like Melania, I'm doing well. Put my pennies in a safe, not a wishing well. I can never mess with Snake like I'm Splinter Cell. Hit Carvello, told him send a pack at once. Right now. One take Billy, I don't have to do a punch. Look, I just ate the beat, I don't have to take a lunch. You the captain of the captain, only cap I like is crunch.